A lot of things that we could have done in this hour. Usually during the Bible class hour, we have some of our young men speaking. Generally, we have some of them speak during the Bible class hour, and then some of them speak at worship. But because we are doing our COVID stuff right now, and we have two morning worship services going on, we decided to put the young men at the two worship services, which did not leave any of them during the Bible class hour. And so I thought about what we ought to do during this time, but I thought I'd spend some time just telling you some information about our leadership training camp. I know some of you know some of it, but you probably don't know a lot of what we do, what goes into it, and I thought you would be interested in just knowing what happens. Dan Fuller came, one of our elders came and spent part of the day with us, and kids were handling the study just fine. I think Dan got overwhelmed and kind of buried in all of the study we were doing, and so he kind of had his eyes glazed over, and he kind of stumbled out of the room after all the Bible. Just kidding, but I just thought I'd share with you some information just so that you can rejoice in something that this church has been doing. Just some of the history of our leadership training camp. We started in 2001. And we started in 2001, and we called it Future Preachers Training Camp. That was the name of it the first year. And we invited our young men to come and be a part of it, not because we thought all of them would be preachers, but that was just the name we had for it. Taught them how to study the Bible, how to prepare their own lessons and put those together. And as soon as we had that camp, the young ladies in the youth group came to us and said, okay, where's our camp? We had Future Preachers Training Camp. We weren't thinking about a camp for the young ladies, but they came to us and said, where's our camp? And so later in the summer, we put a camp together for them. And the focus of that first camp for our young ladies was basically on how to be a lady in the church and how some things that ladies can do in the church. And after that camp, we had some of our ladies come and teach and speak during that. And it was a great camp, but the girls came to us after the camp and they said, that's not what we want. They said, we want what the boys had. Not that they wanted to be preachers, but the boys had spent time and digging in and learning how to study the Bible, learn how to put together lessons, and they said, that's what we want. We want that same thing for us. And so the next year, in 2002, we changed the name from Future Preachers Training Camp to Leadership Training Camp. And we had a camp for the guys, and we had a camp for the girls, and basically taught the same material in both of those camps, teaching each of them in those camps how to study the Bible, how to put Bible lessons together. And we had separate camps for 8 years, would just run those separately, basically teaching the same thing. But during those 8 years, the campers actually slept in the church building. They slept mostly in these children's classrooms. Down this hallway, we had some adult volunteers, maybe some adult voluntolds with some of them, but adult volunbegged some of them to come down and sleep overnight. And so we were here teaching during the day, but and that may have been some of you who came, and we had an air mattress for you out in the lobby, and we had an adult who would come down here and stay overnight with the campers. While they were sleeping, supposed to be in the classrooms down here, and then we would shuttle them back and forth to some nearby members to get showers, because obviously there's not any showering facilities here, and so we just took them to close by members to get showers at night and in the mornings, and so we did that for 8 years, and then in 2009 we told the young people yesterday. In 2009 we took the leadership training camp for the young men by the hand, and the leadership training camp for the young women by the hand, and we joined them in holy matrimony and married them, and it became the leadership training camp for young men and young women. And since 2009, it has been combined, and so they no longer stay at the church building, just to let you know. They're no longer sleeping here. They now stay in members' homes, and we like to do that instead of sending them back to their own home. We like to get them out of their homes and have that experience where they're staying with some of their fellow campers and staying overnight there. And so this year was our 20th year. It's hard to believe. This is our 20th year. And because of those separate camps we had early on, this was actually our 28th camp that we've done this way, but it has been an outstanding blessing, especially for those of us who have been involved in it through all of these years. So who comes to these? Who participates? That's a little bit of the history, but what are who is involved in the camp? Well, the preachers are the teachers and the coordinators. Dan and Josh and I plan it, coordinate, teach it during the camp. But the campers who come, and not everybody knows this, but the campers who come, it's limited. We it's not open to just everybody to come. It's limited to only PBL young people. And you may think that's kind of closed-minded. We've tried a few times having some from other congregations, and it just did not work out. It's not to make us special and somebody else not. The first year, we had some folks from other congregations, and it just was not what we wanted. It didn't turn out the way we wanted. There's not that level of camaraderie and respect between the teachers and the students, and nothing against those other kids. It did not gel, and it created a few more problems for us than what we were looking for. And so we just said, all right, let's limit it to our youth. But it's limited to our youth who are 13 to 18 years old. Limited it by age. But it's also limited to those who have been baptized. So our kids, 13 to 18 year olds, who are members of the Lord's church, those are the ones who are invited to come and participate. But not just one of our kids, 13 to 18, who's been baptized, but somebody who is mature enough to handle the camp. Just because one of our kids has been baptized doesn't mean that they necessarily automatically are a good fit for the camp. I'll talk a little bit more in a minute about the intensity of the camp. But we have a lot of intense, long periods of Bible study. And there have been years where we've had some young people here that just were not in tune with that. They were not mature enough to handle those kind of things, and that became detrimental to the rest of the camp. Again, nothing against those young people. That's where they were at that time. But we just were looking for those who are interested in being here, interested in digging in. We've had campers over the years. We've had campers over the years whose parents made them come to camp. They have to fill out an application. So we send out the application to them. It's just a one-page easy thing. But we send out an application. They have to fill out an application to come. And so their parents made them fill out the application, made them turn it in, made them come to the camp. And sometimes the parents would tell us that. They'd give us a heads up, which was nice. And other times we weren't aware of that until, the camp started and they're just sitting there, arms crossed and just across, crossed arms and crossed face, and they're not interested. I'm not going to listen. I'm just going to sit back and have a bad attitude. Well, they did. They sat back and they had a bad attitude. We converted some of them during the week and brought them over brought them out of the dark side and brought them over to the good ways of the light. But some of them, some of them remained stubborn in their ways, and that's okay. But leadership training camp is just not for everybody. It's not for every kid. It's not for something that everybody can handle. Again, not everybody necessarily wants to be here, but we try to make it so that those who are here are ready for what's going to happen, and that try to keep one from ruining it for everybody else. This year we had 3 first timers. We had 10 campers. 7 of them had been here years, multiple years. The other ones were here from 3 to 7 years before, and 3 of them were brand new. All of them had the last name of Hayes, but we anticipated great things from them, and you would have never known that they were first year campers. The first time they had sat in those classes with us, but you never would have known that this was the first time that they had been here. They jumped right in like they were seasoned veterans of this. But when the kids come to camp, you might be interested to know that there is a dress code. They are given information before they apply, and then after they apply and they get their letter of confirmation that they're coming, they are given information that says, here's the dress code for camp. And so guys, they are required to wear a collared shirt and nice pants. Girls are required to wear either a dress or skirt or nice pants and a shirt, but nobody is permitted to wear jeans, shorts, or t-shirts during classes. We have recreation, and they're permitted to have shorts and t-shirts for the recreation time. But during class, I mean, the girls' dresses are obviously modest dresses. But during class time, they're dressed up, which is not maybe what you would expect to happen. But there's something about our attire. We tell them this in the camp. There's something about our attire that affects our attitude. It affects our mindset. It affects our behavior. You know, if they had run in here from the beach with their bathing suits on and their flip-flops on with their wet towel around their shoulders, okay, let's study the Bible. The mindset isn't there. And not that the clothes do it all, but you sit a certain way when you're dressed a certain way, and it's interesting just the way that affects us. And so it's nice looking around. Sometimes all the guys are wearing ties right now because they're speaking today, but sometimes they'll have a tie on during class. We don't require a tie, but they put their best foot forward in that, and it's exciting. So why do we have leadership training camp then? What's the purpose of it? Why did we start it? I guess we could probably state the purpose in a variety of ways. I think first of all, what the purpose is not. The purpose of leadership training camp is not to create preachers. I wish every young man that came through LTC became a preacher. I would love for that to happen. I know it's not going to. But even when it was called Future Preachers Training Camp, we didn't have in mind that everybody going through that and everybody coming out was going to be a preacher. But that's not the purpose of LTC. We want them to think about it, and we'd love for that to be the case. The purpose is not, and we tell the kids this, the purpose is not to get them ready for Sunday. There's some similar camps, at least from an outsider's perspective, there's some similar camps to this that happen where it seems that the purpose is to get the kids ready to stand up before the church on Sunday. And that may be my bad on evaluation of looking at what some other camps do. But that's not our purpose. Our purpose is not, okay, it's Wednesday now, we need to get you ready for what you're going to do on Sunday. We don't even talk about Sunday on Wednesday or Thursday. That's not our focus. The kids, because they've been here, they know that Sunday's going to come. But Sunday is just an opportunity. What they're doing today is not a requirement of the camp. They do not have to stand up. We tell them that. We encourage them to. We want them to. But they don't have to stand up and speak on Sunday. And so that's not the purpose of the camp is not to get them ready for Sunday. The purpose of the camp is not to spoon feed them an outline. Say, here's an outline that Josh wrote. This would be really good for you to use. You work on this a little bit, then you stand up and practice it, and you'll look really good on Sunday. You'll make the preachers look like geniuses. Mm-mm. That's not the purpose of LTC. And that's not what we do at all. What we do is we teach them, here's how you study the Bible. We teach them, here's how you prepare a lesson, because we're trying to create and prepare them to be strong, mature Christians. I doubt you guys have your binders. I think girls bring their binders on Sundays. I don't think the guys bring their binders. So probably one of the girls has got their binder today. But they all are given a one-inch binder when they come that's full of stuff. But on the front of the binder, it states the purpose of the camp. And LTC, it says that this camp is designed to instill two things. It's a camp that's designed to instill confidence, number one, and skills, number two. To instill confidence and skills that are needed in order that they might become an active member of the church. Not to make them preachers, but to give them confidence that I can do this, to give them the skills that they know how to do certain things with the Bible and with Bible study, so that when they leave Palm Beach Lakes, and while they're still here, they can be an active member of the church. I had an LTC alum email me last week, somebody who had been in LTC probably about 15 years ago, and she was singing the praises, if you can sing praises in an email, she was singing the praises of LTC, not to pat the preachers or anybody on the back, but just her fond memories 15 years ago of being in this camp, and asking me if we still had the materials that were presented in the camp, because she was asked where she is now. Where she is now, she was asked to teach a ladies' class on a particular topic. And she said, "Do you have what we talked about in LTC 15 years ago?" She remembered what we did. She remembered the skills and the confidence that were given to her in the camp 15 years ago. And here she is now as an adult, married and living somewhere else, saying, I want to take what I had back then and still use it. That's not to pat anybody on the back, but just to say, that's what we want. That's what we want for every one of these kids that goes through this camp, is to be wherever they are as an adult and to have that confidence and skills that, yeah, I can do this. And maybe be in a congregation where they're given multiple opportunities to do that. So let me tell you what we did this year. Just give you kind of an overview of LTC. And most camps, we do the same thing. There's a lot of things that we do every year. But it's basically a 3.5-day camp. We start Wednesday morning at 9 o'clock, go all day Wednesday, all day Thursday, all day Friday, and then we go a half a day on Saturday. And during the camp, we start every morning with some kind of exercise that's geared towards public speaking. But it's easy and fun stuff. Part of it, we do it in the morning to get their juices flowing. They've got the coffee flowing, but now we want to get the juices flowing, get some energy going. And so we do some things that are geared towards public speaking. One thing we do some mornings, it's called spoken English. And what spoken English is, it's an activity that we do that's designed to help them deal with stage fright. It's designed to help them to deal with just standing up in front of people and talking, which nobody is comfortable doing. This will be one of the things we'll do first thing in the morning. And every camper is involved in this. It's not volunteers. It's not who wants to do this. Every time we do it, every camper is involved in spoken English. And what we do, we're in adult one and two. We have adult one and two opened up, and we're facing, got the tables long way, facing the long side of the room. And so the podium is there, and they'll come up and stand, and they're standing there in front of their peers. And they take turns one by one doing that. And when they come and stand at the podium, they are given a random topic to talk about. They have no clue. Before they get to the podium, they have no clue what they're going to talk about. It's not a Bible topic. It's just some random topic that's given to them, like shoestrings or snot or what were some of the ones that you all had this year? Goats. They did talk about goats. What were some of your favorites? Sheep. Or what did we talk about? What did you say? Oh, yeah. Daniel's topic was vomit. What did you have, Tyler?
Earwax.
You had donut holes too, didn't you? That was one of your topics. So they're given some random topic. I think one of the guys was given the topic of putting on makeup. And so it's a random topic that as soon as they get the topic, they have to start talking about that topic. There's no preparation. It's to teach them to think on their feet. And so there's no preparation. You just hear this topic and you start talking about this topic, and you can talk basically. The rules are you talk until you make a mistake. You talk until you say, or. Do you realize how often you say that when you're speaking and when you're public speaking? How often you say or. And so sometimes they'll get a topic, stand there, say, "My name is," and they'll be given the topic, speak about donut holes, donut holes. The first word out of their mouth is, so generally the rule is if you do that, you got to sit down. Your turn is over. But generally we're lenient because we want to hear, what are you going to say about donut holes off the top of your head? But the idea is to get them comfortable talking in front of people, to stand up and to remove some of that stage fright. You know, it's fun, but there's a purpose behind it. You remember Karate Kid? You know, and Karate Kid was doing all of these things, and he's like, what has this got to do with karate? Well, what?
Paint the fence.
Wax on, wax off. You know, and so, there was a purpose. He didn't get it. There's a purpose behind it. Spoken English, purpose behind it. You know, stand up in front of people, remove some stage fright, get you comfortable. Another thing we do is called coming out of the shell. And we come in here in the auditorium for that. Purpose of coming out of the shell is to get you to speak up. Purpose of coming out of the shell is to get you to project your voice, which some of our young people don't have a problem with. But when you get up, and you men know this, that when you get up in front of a group, all of a sudden the projecting of your voice is not so comfortable doing. Some voices project more naturally than others, but even if you're not projecting naturally, and so coming out of the shell, we come in here. And the idea is for them to talk passionately about some topic and to get them to speak out, to speak up, and to voice. And so sometimes what we did this year is come in here and you stand around the auditorium and you are a different animal. And you're an alphabetical animal. And you name an animal and you act like an animal. And you make the sound of an animal. But you have to be heard everywhere else in the auditorium. And then while that's happening, other people are coming at you and kind of shouting you down, which makes you speak up even louder. You may think that sounds like chaos, and it is in some respects, but it's wax on, wax off. There's a purpose. There's a purpose behind it. And even in that setting, it's still hard to hear. It's still hard for them to speak up. And so the purpose is you got to project your voice. And so there are some things, and those are things we do. We do something like that every morning, just to get them up, get them moving in the morning, but to teach some of these kind of public speaking skills. And then on Wednesday morning, after we've, first morning, we come together at 9 o'clock, we just introduce the camp, we do spoken English, we pass out their one-inch binders that has a bunch of information in it. We go over we don't have camp rules, we call them camp expectations. Here's what we expect from you during camp this year. And so we go over all of that, and then somewhere around 9:45, 10 o'clock, we jump in, and we start studying. The first thing that we do, sorry, Scott, I'll be right back. The first thing we do every Wednesday morning of LTC is we start by teaching them how to use Bible study tools. And so we'll start with Cruden's Concordance. And we've got a worksheet that we go through together, and we teach them, here's what a concordance is, here's what it does, here's how you use it. And so we'll look up words using Cruden's Concordance so that they, again, what's the purpose of LTC? Confidence and skills. We want them to have confidence and skills that they can find a verse in the Bible. So we'll introduce them to Cruden's Concordance. After we teach them Cruden's Concordance, then we get out the big guy, and we teach them Strong's. Notice the difference between, you can't see this, I'm sure, this is called Cruden's Complete Concordance. Complete's a little misnomer, but it's complete. It doesn't have every single word in the Bible, but it's got most of the ones you're going to look up. But notice the difference, if you can, you can't read that because it's so small. Strong's is called Exhaustive Concordance, and it is. It has every single A, the, of, it in the Bible listed. But what we teach them with the difference is, with Strong's, we teach them how they can find the Greek word in the New Testament or the Hebrew word from the Old Testament, how they can find the Greek word that is behind whatever the English word is in our New Testament, in our English translations. So they seem to enjoy doing that. Well, we'll look, again, we have a worksheet, we'll look something up, and we'll say, what's the Greek word for that? And then we go to the back of Strong's and find the word, find the definition that Strong's gives. So we'll spend some time going through Strong's. And then we teach them, we get out Vines. And the thing about our camp is that we have copies of these books for everybody. So it's not just that, you know, the teacher standing up front and holding a book up and say, hey, look at this book. We have enough copies of these books that every camper is given one at a time. They've got these books sitting in front of them. And so then we'll pass out Vine's Expository Dictionary. Not an English dictionary. It's a dictionary of the Hebrew terms from the Old Testament dictionary of the Greek terms from the New Testament. And so we will use vines to look up particular words that are found in the New Testament. What does this word mean in the original language? Not what does it mean in English, that's Webster's dictionary. What did it mean in the original language? What did it mean to those people to whom it was being written? And with the newer Vines dictionaries that are available now, they key these things back into Strong's numbers so that you can compare and make sure that when you're looking at a term in Vines, you know it's exactly that word that was used in Romans chapter 12 and verse 9. And so we teach them Vines, and then we spend time teaching them and going through Thompson Chain Reference Bible, which you may not be familiar with, but this is... my estimation, the best study Bible that's available. Some study Bibles will have like commentary in the middle of your Bible and that kind of thing, which is interesting and not necessarily always the most accurate thing. But what Thompson does for the most part is called Thompson Chain Reference Bible, is he takes Bible topics and he chains those topics together. He'll take a topic like humility. Daniel spoke about humility. And so you can look up in the back of Thompson Chain Reference, you can look up his topic of humility, and he will divide humility up into various sections. Here's humility that's commanded by God. Here's humility, examples of it in the New Testament. Here's humility of Jesus. Here's humility of whatever. He'll divide it up into various topics, and then he'll have verses for each of those subtopics. And it's a chain reference because if you go back, go up and read a verse from Psalms about humility, then he'll have a link in the margin that says, okay, now go to this verse. Okay, now you've read this verse from Matthew. Okay, go read this verse. And it's a chain link that you just follow it all the way through the Bible, or you can look at it in the back. But a great study help for looking up Bible topics. And so we will spend basically all of Wednesday morning. We'll spend at least an hour and a half, sometimes 2 hours, just going through the tools. And again, they will have all of these in their hands and using them. And it's kind of fun, you know. They've got their 1-inch binder. They've got these books, and you know, at some point they'll start stacking them up. And you know, it's fun to watch the girls stack their books up and carry them to another room when they're ready to do that. And you know, of course, they've got their Bible on top because you always put your Bible on top. The Bible doesn't go down below any other books. The Bible's always on top, but you know, they've got all this stuff they're trying to carry around. But the purpose is, we want them, what is it? Confidence, skills. We do this every year. Some of you have been in the camp 3 years, some 5 years, some 7 years. They've done this 3 years, 5 years, 7 years. Not the same words. We have different words, different worksheets that we'll go through. But as a reminder, as a refresher, when you leave leadership training camp, you can do this. You can know how to study the Bible. You can know how to look things up. You can know how to find answers on your own. And so we teach them these. That's Wednesday morning. But then we use these the rest of the week. We teach them how to use them at the beginning of the camp so that the rest of the camp we can spend time using those in our study and developing various things from those tools. I'm going to tell you about that in just a minute. We give overnight assignments, Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night. There's overnight assignments. And again, those always have a purpose. We tell them it's not busy work. Did you ever have a teacher in school who just gave you busy work? Just like, here, just do this. And didn't really have a purpose. You know, why am I doing this? It was just like, just to keep you out of their hair and keep you busy, right? That's not the purpose of our assignments. They're not busy work. There's an intent. There's a purpose behind them. They're not long assignments. It might take them 10 to 20 minutes, maybe on most of them, to do these overnight assignments. We do have recreation Thursdays and Friday nights, so don't think that we're locking them in a room and just studying the Bible for 24 hours a day. There is, Josh planned some, we had some fun recreation this year. Thursday and Friday nights, and these kids are very competitive. We don't have an award called Most Competitive Award. Maybe we should make up an award called Most Competitive Award. But Tyler would just win it every year. Is the problem? That young man is competitive, which is not a bad thing. That's a good thing. He wants to excel, But the thing with Tyler, and the thing with all of them, I don't want to pick on Tyler, the thing with all of them is how inclusive they are in everything. Should I tell them about the trees? I mean, one of the activities we did, was it Friday night? Again, it's guys versus girls. Everything we did this week was guys versus girls. I mean, 5-on-5, it was always guys. And Josh had some really cool games. We played some inside, some outside. But you know what? And there's probably some pictorial and video evidence of two of our campers. The teams took them out to the big palm trees that are right out there out front. Stood one boy up on a chair on this tree, or I guess the girl was on this tree and the boy was on this tree standing on a chair, and each team was given a box of Saran wrap and two rolls of duct tape, and they Saran wrapped and duct taped their team member to the tree. Saran wrap first so that the duct tape's a little more comfortable, but they wrapped that Saran wrap around their team. They seemed to enjoy it. They really loved it. And Grayson was good sport. Vivian was a good sport, and they wrapped them to the trees, and then part of the competition was to see how quickly they could get their team member off of the tree, they could get their team member off the tree. But anyway, you might think that just sounds absolutely bizarre that you would do that kind of thing. If you've been studying the Bible for 6 hours straight, you need a little bizarre. You need a little bit of a release from that, and so we enjoyed that. Of course, we've got they pull out the ping pong and the foosball tables, and they do that after lunch as well. But anyway, all right, that's leadership training camp. What do? Wednesday morning, teach them the tools, and then sometimes Wednesday before lunch if we have time. But for sure, from Wednesday after lunch for the rest of Wednesday, all of Thursday, all of Friday, We are digging into some Bible subject. We're digging into something. Each year it's different. We rotate what we do. Sometimes it's a topical study. I think it was last year was baptism, or was it year before? I think it was last year we studied baptism, and so we used the tools and just dug into what does the New Testament teach about baptism, and sometimes it's textual. And so this year it was Romans chapter 12, and we spent Wednesday afternoon, all day Thursday, all day Friday, digging into, well, half of the day Friday, digging into Romans chapter 12. I mean, you may think and look at that and say, it's only got 21 verses. Why does it take you so long? We spent hours and hours. We started Romans chapter 12 after lunch. After lunch on Wednesday, we started Romans chapter 12. And I think around 4 o'clock on Wednesday, we had finished verse 2 of chapter 12. You figure out, and that's not wasting time. There's a lot involved in what we're doing and trying to teach them how to get through. And so what we did is we dug into every word of every verse. They had in their binder sheets that had one page, and it had one verse from the chapter on the page. And we dug into nearly every word that was in that chapter. We got out the vines, which vines and Strong's were our friend that day. And we dug into every one of those words. They were looking them up, spent hours and hours studying these. Sometimes we'd study, ladies, come on in. We're going to keep talking about LTC until you're in. Sometimes we'd spend an hour and a half to 2 hours just study without a break, just straight. They would sit there and just study and study with us, digging into this. And then come Friday, we say, okay, now that we've studied this, we teach them how to put a lesson together. We teach them how to gather information together, how to develop their topics, how to outline a lesson. We teach them how to outline, how to stand up and present. We teach them how to saturate their lessons with the Bible. We're not interested in them sharing their opinions. And I'm sure the ladies just heard 5 lessons that were full of Bible verses, because that's all that matters when you're standing up and teaching, is that it is full of Scripture. And so what they do is they will start right before lunch on Friday, and they'll take the rest of Friday, and they will develop their lessons. We do not spoon feed them their outlines. They develop their lessons. And so on Friday, they sat from 1 o'clock until 6 o'clock. They sat from 1 o'clock until 6 o'clock, 5 hours, without us taking a break, without us doing it. They sat for 5 hours working on their lessons that they're presenting today. They wanted to do, they're not being forced to do that. They wanted to do that. And so they're digging into their tools. They're digging into the Bible. They're doing these studies. And the lessons that they are presenting today are their lessons. Preachers come around. We talk to them. We help them. We share ideas with them. We give them some things to look up and some things that might help them. But it's their lessons. And so on Saturday morning, we come together. They practice their lessons. We give them some input on their lessons. But what they do today, they have not been forced. Nobody has been forced to speak today. It's their choice. You come to LTC, you do not have to stand up and speak on Sunday. It's your option. We're thankful this year that all 10 of them chose that they wanted to speak. But let me say this as we wrap up and say something that we said at the beginning of this particular talk. And that is that the purpose of LTC is not to get the kids ready for Sunday. That'd be a really short-sighted purpose if that was the purpose. The purpose is to instill within them the confidence and the skills that they can and need to become an active part of the church for the rest of their life wherever they go. We are trying to prepare them not for Sunday. We're trying to prepare them for life in the church. Young people, this has been an outstanding year, an outstanding camp, one of the best that I can remember. And they walk away from this week realizing Christianity. Remember the sermon from last week? That Christianity can be a blast. Studying the Bible can be a blast. And I think that they would, if they'd be honest with you, I think they would admit to you that they had fun this last week studying the Bible. Can you believe you can have fun studying the Bible? They did. We spent hours and hours and hours doing it. And I'm so thankful for them, for their hearts and their dedication this past week. Some of you came in, and if you're interested, what we've been talking about in here the last few minutes, just talking about leadership training camp, what we do, and if you're interested in knowing what we do in LTC, where it came from, and things that happen, you can go online and listen to this later on.